sights on both of those enemies of America. To help us with that, we're pleased to be joined by Lieutenant Colonel Tony Schaefer. He's the president of the Herb London Center for Policy Research and author of Operation Dark Heart, Spycraft and Special Ops on the Front Lines of Afghanistan and the Path to Victory. Colonel Schaefer, thanks for joining us again. Appreciate it.
Hey, Dan, always great to join you. Thanks for having me.
Before we get to Russia, I just wanted to get your reaction to the Biden administration announcement of the diplomatic boycott of the Beijing Olympics and the Chi-Com's response that it's a self-directed political farce. I mean, a lot of rhetorical saber-rattling signifying not very much. But was that the right move by the Biden administration? And if so, what's move number two?
Well, it was the right move if they wanted to play right into the hands of China, which they did. It's kind of like, we're not going to show up. And the Chinese basically said, yeah, you shouldn't show up. You're really not invited. You're not relevant. And that echoes into the other issue of credibility and Russia. And I think that's the other meandering foreign policy with no end state that the Biden administration is currently engaged in is this kind of, I would say almost, it's not even like someone is not in charge. It's like they're in charge, but saying the wrong thing. Like you point out regarding China, the thing that China would have dreaded is a strong power saying, you know, because of your Uyghur policy, because of your use of slave labor, because of this, that, and the other, we're going to financially disenfranchise you. We're going to stop. We're not going to show up. We're not going to participate. We're going to force our corporations to not participate. And instead, right now, with just this political slogan of, oh, we're not going to send representation, but our athletes are going and U.S. corporations are participating, the Chinese are going to make billions. They're going to get out of this the prestige that they seek, the recognition. And this administration has shown again that it's completely feckless and unable to actually manage any strong foreign policy issues at all.
All right, now let's move over. Oh, did you want to?
First, I mean, right. At the same time there, this is happening, you have Apple Inc., a $250 billion deal with the Chinese. So what does that say to the Chinese about the relevance of the Biden administration, even in America?
Well, that says everything about it by the fact that that did not happen on Biden's watch. That happened before even Trump came to office. I think it was in early 2016. With that said, the fact that there's going to be no addressing it is what the Chinese need to know. And obviously they know, and even though we now know this, DOJ is not going to do anything. The U.S. government, the State Department's not going to do anything to actually hold Apple accountable. And if you recall, this was known to us in a way because during this time, General Dunford, the former chairman of the Joint Chiefs under President Trump, actually said that a number of big corporations were engaged in activities that were not supportable regarding the U.S. positions in China. He actually said this in testimony. And I think we knew at the time, but we did not do enough to actually hold people accountable. So this is something of an ongoing issue where I think both multiple administrations have been unwilling to call the Chinese out. And of course, since I am one of those that do believe, based on the Bobulinski evidence on Hunter Biden's hard drive, that Biden was paid a certain amount of money, that is both Hunter Biden and Joe Biden, via Hunter, were paid a certain amount of money by China. And I do believe that's a relevant investigative predicate that should be looked at. And I do believe that one of the reasons you see such a weak response from China, regarding China from Biden, is because of this payment he received at some point.
Yeah, because, I mean, honestly, if you look at what they've all done, you know, crushing the democracy movement in Hong Kong, threatening Taiwan,
right,
the top tennis star, you know, Peng Shuai missing, why not pull a Jimmy Carter and what he did in 1980 in the Moscow Olympics? Because Russia was invading Afghanistan, why not just have a complete boycott? And you think it's because of the Biden's and Hunter's tie to China?
I think it's because of the tie. Because even the most, I think, incredulous, ineffective Democrat to date, which was Jimmy Carter, I think we would all agree, is being eclipsed by Biden, because at least Biden could show some teeth by saying, we're not going to show up, we're not going to reach you anymore. Apple, your behavior is not acceptable. We have to relook this sort of thing. I mean, look, they're the ones always wanting to control corporations. This would be not a great opportunity to jump in there and control Apple, because they could justify going in there looking around with DOJ because of the overseas activities. But no, they're not, because I do believe, and again, I do believe this is a valid investigative predicate that I hope the next Congress and if they're Republican can get into with real investigators, the fact that there are multiple credible sources. And I know the guy who turned the Hunter Biden hard drive in to the FBI, I know personally. He's an Air Force colonel I worked with on nuclear weapons issues about 10 years ago. So I know, and his nephew is JP. So I know the chain of custody. I know the people involved. I have no doubt that computer, that the hard drive from hell is real. And I think that's why we see this completely lackluster response to real China issues from the Biden administration.
What's your assessment of the probability of a Russian invasion in Ukraine in the Donbass?
I think it's better than 90%.
Really?
And here's why. So, yeah, look, this the Russians are not the Soviets, but the Soviets were the Russians. And I think you need to look at how the Soviets behaved during the time they were in power. And Vladimir Putin himself has been seeking to return to empire. He's wanted that Soviet empire back. So if you put those two things together and you look at the completely feckless response of the Biden administration to all things Russian, I think the chances are Putin's already made his decision. I think he's just enjoying the moment. He could go as soon as Christmas. I was talking to a number of analysts the other day about this because, you know, we all came through the Cold War together. And one of our biggest fears during the Cold War was that on some Christmas, the Warsaw Pact would come across the border and attack during one of our most vulnerable times. Well, to me, the stars are all lining up, Dan, for complete vulnerability. We have a feckless president who can't even say the United States of America clearly when it's on a teleprompter for him yesterday. He messed that up. You have Jake Sullivan at the White House telegraphing that there'll be no military response, that we have all these sanctions involved in mind, which Putin probably has already planned around as a part of his military planning for the invasion, the incursion.
And yeah, then we're going to shut off their pipeline.
Right. And then as a third thing, it's like, well, we're going to shut off their payments. Like, well, they own the gas, so I don't think they're going to be worried about, you know, they're going to get paid somehow, because NATO has now been, I think, neutered by the very fact you said, Amy. They basically keep Europe warm during the winter. So who's going to shut off your own oil to all your people during the winter? So that's why I think the stars are all aligned in Putin's favor. So and I think the chances are pretty good. I don't know if he'll take all of Ukraine, but I think he's going to take a big slice of it pretty quick. And this is one of those issues where do we say enough's enough? Because I keep hearing that, well, you know, Ukraine's not in our strategic interest. I think, well, it is and it isn't, because right next to Ukraine is Poland. They are one of our allies. They are a NATO member. They do have the Article 5 requirements, so that's something to consider. But more importantly, and you may not laugh at this, but another Democrat administration, the Clinton administration, back in the 90s, 94, gave their word to Ukraine through this Budapest memorandum. If they gave up their nuclear weapons, that is to say they gave up all the nuclear weapons they had, that is to say they had about one-third of the old Soviet Union's nuclear weapons on their territory. If you give up your nuclear weapons, we, the United States and NATO, will guarantee your territorial sovereignty. Well, it appears that may be broken here very soon by another Democrat administration. I don't think they're going to live up to it.
That was broken when we allowed the Russians to take Crimea, right?
That's correct. That's correct.
So why would Putin think that that has any teeth?
Exactly.
It obviously doesn't.
Exactly.
Well, then what should the response be? I mean, there's some talk about, you know, we've sent, $2.5 billion of weapons and security assistance over the last half dozen years to Ukraine. And there's
blankets.
Talk of sending more weapons. But we send more weapons and Putin provides more weapons to separatists in the Donbass region. So, I mean, does that accomplish anything?
Well, it does, but it doesn't. What we've had is a type of parity where neither side has been able to gain advantage. And I don't believe Putin would be considering this aggressive action if President Trump was still in office, because one of the other things that Trump is willing to do, and I don't think Biden is covert actions. One of the things I've known as an operative who worked in the shadows for most of his career is simply because you have a focus on one territory doesn't mean you can't do things in other places. And so one of the things we could have done is made it very clear to Putin that there's going to be a cost to the activity if you do this, there'll be other bad things happen. And I don't even know off the top of my head what those would be, but I do know the Russians have interests, they have vulnerabilities, and those things under normal circumstance would be targeted to remind him. It's like, you know, there's a downside, there's a cost to doing this.
So if now, sorry, go on.
Yeah, go ahead.
No, go on. I didn't mean right up front.
So the policy has to be, and this is a policy issue. This is a political will issue. Do you have the political will to say this is our policy and we're going to invoke and implement that policy through all of these other avenues? And so the answer is, at this point, Amy, there's no indication we're doing any of that. So, again, in Putin's mind, he's not being threatened. He's not being told there's going to be a specific cost other than we're going to make sure it's harder for you to get your bills paid. I think this is all just more weakness. And the issue then becomes, where is the line? Where do we, you know, okay, Putin does this, and okay, it's no big deal. What happens if he decides to go for Poland? Poland is one of those countries which has been a very strong democracy trying to develop itself, a very close ally. What happens then if Putin says, I want Poland back too, because Poland was part of the Warsaw Pact. That's something I want. And so this is something we have to consider. So we may, you know, turn the other way and let Ukraine go. But I always look back at World War II, how we allowed country after country to kind of fall into a fascist, you know, under Hitler, and how it took so much time for people to recognize he wasn't going to stop and back down until he, you know, had everything he wanted. So
some foreign policy wonks are suggesting that one of the things the Biden administration do is prompt Kiev to redouble efforts to achieve some sort of comprehensive diplomatic settlement with Moscow and those separatists in that Donbass region. Is that, from what I'm hearing from you, is that that's without point? Putin has made his decision.
Yeah, it's without point because all the indicators are that there's going to be really no consequences for his aggressive action. Putin's a thug. I think he actually enjoys being a thug. I mean, people I've spoken to who know him fairly well have said that he has murdered a reporter in an elevator in Moscow because he didn't like her reporting. This guy is not a good guy. So I think that if he can use thuggery and aggressive action and get away with it, he's going to do it. And so, remember, he's a KGB guy. I hate to go and use these stereotypes, but he is a KGB guy. And he came through a very brutal system. And we always sell ourselves short by trying to put ourselves, our values, we project those onto him. He's not a Western guy. These people came through a system that's very brutal and where power and might makes right. I think that's what he wants to do. I think the green light's been given. I think he's probably going to do it.
Even if we have no inclination to send ground troops there, is it judicious for Jake Sullivan, National Security Advisor, to announce that?
No, it would not. It is not. It's never, ever a good idea to take options off the table. Remember, Jake Sullivan, what I found ironic, Dan, if you remember his presentation on this, well, you know, we're not going to make the same mistakes we did in 2014. It's like, dude, you are. The same team that was in managing the debacle with Crimea isn't in there again. And I think that was another telegraph. It's like, yeah, we're not going to do anything. So, no, it's not a good idea because that does just, again, reinforce Putin's thinking that, hey, there's not going to be any big deal here. Now, we do have some advisors on the ground. I'm told about 200 U.S. Personnel are still there doing various things with the military. I suspect that should the Russians go, they're going to be some of the first ones told because I don't think Putin wants to antagonize us based on the concierge support we're giving him and giving him the green light to go in there. So
he is Lieutenant Colonel Tony Schaefer, President Herb London Center for Policy Research, author of Operation Darkheart, Spycraft and Special Ops on the Front Lines of Afghanistan and the Path to Victory. Colonel Schaefer, thanks for joining us again. Appreciate it.
Thanks. Yeah, thanks, Annie. And thanks, Dan.
Thank you. And he joined us on our turnkey.pro answer line.
The stories you need to know to start your day. This is Chicago's Morning Answer. On AM 560, The Answer.
Before Bamboo HR, I feel like crying just thinking about it.
We were still handling everything via paper, and we literally had paper stacked.
It was all in spreadsheets and like folders.
From the moment I started using it, I felt calmer.
As soon as we started using the Bamboo like onboarding checklist, I mean, it was extremely easy.
Headcount, turnover, years of service. Like there's just so many different reports that I use at different points in time.
I'm like totally set free to focus on the people, to focus on development, to focus on team dynamics.
It's freeing me up to do more of the stuff that actually matters in HR, which is interacting with people, learning from them, and then building stuff for them.
Everything is in this one place. I can't even imagine what it would be like with